Next speaker is Alberto Perez. Do you want to go ahead and load your slides?
Okay, can you see my screen?
Yes. Okay. Take it away, Alberto.
Thank you.
Go ahead.
Thank you very much for the organizers to giving me the opportunity of presenting this work in this conference. I'm going to talk about phase amplitude description for stochastic oscillators, a work I have the pleasure to work with Peter Thomas and Benjamin Lindner. Well, I'm not sure if I need to motivate this talk for this audience, because we know stochastic oscillations occur throughout natural and engineered systems, and in particular in neuroscience, we have a bunch of examples of stochastic oscillations. So as a mathematician, a question now will be how to characterize or how to approach these dynamics. And if I had to choose, I would like to have something, a framework, which is kind of similar as the framework that we have to describe deterministic oscillations. Because we know in a system of deterministic ODEs, oscillations arise from stable limit cycles having a finite period. And as it was said before, typically these kind of systems are described in terms of a phase variable or one dimensional variable. And during the last decade, the analysis of limit cycles through phase amplitude reduction, adding an amplitude variable, as I have been said before, provide an essentially complete understanding of oscillatory dynamics, as you can see, for example, in this review. Well, let me give you a brief detail about what is phase amplitude reduction. That is, you have a system of ODEs having a T-happy body limit cycle. And then you know that it exists a nonlinear change of variables, such that the dynamics of your system express linearly, where you have the phase and you have in here the amplitude, where capital lambda is a diagonal matrix whose elements correspond to the characteristic exponents of the limit cycle, which we assume negative because we consider stable limit cycles. Computing this change of variables for large dimensional systems is something I did as a PhD in this work with my PhD advisors, Teresa Arangé Mouguet, following the work from the mathematicians from Universitat Politécnica de Catalunya, as Toni Guillamón, Oriol Castejón. And well, as I was saying, the analysis of limit cycles through the phase amplitude reduction provide a complete understanding of oscillatory dynamics. And next, I aim to show how to find an analogous phase amplitude description of stochastic oscillators. To that aim, I will start reviewing this work by Peter Thomas and Benjamin Lindner, in which they define and compute an asymptotic phase for stochastic oscillators. Well, from now on, we will consider systems Langevin equations, and we will interpret it in the sense of Ito. Okay, we could consider systems with white noise. And because of adding noise, the picture changes completely, because now we are not restricted to having underlying limit cycles. We know oscillations can arise when putting noise from a wide variety of scenarios, having what we call noise-induced oscillations, systems which oscillate because of noise. Moreover, transit times between Poincaré sections are random variables. Large time asymptotic behavior no longer disambiguates initial conditions. So all in all, a shift in perspective is required to tackle this problem. Well, instead of considering individual trajectories, we will describe, we will consider an example of trajectories through the conditional density. Okay, here the conditional density, that is the probability of being at Y at time T if you were at X at time S, okay? This conditional density evolves according to the forward and backwards equations that you have in here. Just let me say before, L and L dagger correspond to the Kolmogorov forward and backwards operator. This is because using here the Kolmogorov forwards is because you are derivating respect to the forward time. And in here, the Kolmogorov backwards operator, you are derivating respect to the backward time. Okay, that is because that is what the origin of the name. Well, we will assume these operators, L and L dagger, admit a complete eigenfunction expansion. So if that happened, this eigenfunction expansion allows us to write the conditional density as a sum, where P0, suitably normalized, represents the unique stationary probability distribution. Then, under these conditions, Peter Thomas and Benjamin Lindner define a stochastic system as robustly oscillatory if these three conditions hold. That is, the non-trivial eigenvalue with least negative real part is complex, there is this relationship between the eigenvalues or the real and the imaginary parts of this eigenvalue, and all the other eigenvalues satisfy this relationship. If these conditions hold, we can extract an stochastic asymptoting phase that we will denote as C of X from the slowest decaying complex eigenfunctions of L ladder. And now let me show you an example in this paper to illustrate this. In this paper, Peter and Benjamin consider a Jean-Markov process version of the cycadic model. So you have in here a typical neural model in the sense that you have the voltage, the conductance variables. And then what they did is for two levels of noise, they build the L-ladder operator and they diagonalize it. One level of noise corresponds to the L2, you have in here the eigenvalues, and the other to the black. So, and they focus on the eigenfunctions associated to the eigenvalues having being complex and having the least negative real part, okay? Then this eigenfunction, which is complex, can be written in polar coordinates, so you can extract a phase from the argument of this complex number. And for example, you can see how the isochrons of this phase function compare to the deterministic ones, which are the ones in blue in this plot. It turns out that in this picture, there were one detail which was missed. As you can see, these two guys in here were also claiming attention. Why? Because the eigenfunction associated with the least negative non-trivial, purely real eigenvalue plays a very important role as well. In particular, it allows for the definition and computation of the stochastic isostables. In order to obtain this amplitude or isostable stochastic isostable coordinates, we maintain the same conditions as Peter and Benjamin did in his previous work, and we specialize to the case of planar systems. We will assume that the L-ladder has a unique real least negative eigenvalue that we will denote as lambda floquet. And we will denote its corresponding eigenfunction but capital sigma. Then, as you can check, the expected value of the amplitude function evaluated on the individual trajectories, okay, decays in the mean following these dynamics. That, as you can see, is formally analogous to the deterministic amplitude dynamics. That is why we interpret capital sigma as the generalization of the amplitude or isostable coordinate for the stochastic system. And moreover, the same way for an ODE system, the limit cycle coincides with the sets of points having zero amplitude, we propose to regard the zero level set of this amplitude function as the generalization of the limit cycles to a stochastic system. And furthermore, the same way we can take profit of this amplitude stochastic amplitude function, because the same way for an ODE system, we were having this relationship between the phase and the amplitude and the vector and the deterministic vector field. Since we are considering for this phase amplitude construction two functions, Q and sigma, whose expected values evolve deterministically, we can use it to define and compute a vector field satisfying this relationship. And as I will show you, the real part of this vector field will show us how the noise modifies effectively the underlying vector field. And what do I mean by modifying effectively? Well, it's the following. Since we are using the stochastic isostable function sigma to compute the effective vector field, you see in here, it turns out that the amplitude function of this effective vector field is exactly sigma. Therefore, while the underlying vector field of the stochastic system needs not to support a limit cycle solution, the real part of this effective vector field will have it. In particular, since the amplitude function is exactly the capital C, the stochastic amplitude, the limit cycle that is having this effective vector field will correspond exactly to the stochastic limit cycle. So as you will see in our examples, numerical examples that I next illustrate, effectively, we're showing how the vector field is changed to generate that limit cycle. Well, I'm going to illustrate all this machinery by applying to different examples. First of all, I will start by an Stewart-Landau oscillator that is well known. Okay. We will set parameters so it has a limit cycle, the underlying system has a limit cycle. And first, we will start considering the case of isotropic noise. Well, what we do, we will be always doing the same thing. We build the LDAPR operator for this system. We diagonalize it and we focus on the eigenfunctions associated to the eigenvalues of interest. That is, the one being complex, having the smallest negative part, real part, and the one being purely real, having the smallest real part, okay? We consider its associated eigenfunctions, and as I explained before, we can use it to compute a phase and amplitude functions that we can use to compute the phase and amplitude description of individual stochastic trajectories. You can see here the individual trajectory, and in here you have the corresponding phase amplitude description. Well, what I was trying, what is the meaning of this stochastic limit cycle? Well, to illustrate it, let me take, instead of one trajectory, let me take a large number. I took 15 for the sake of illustration, and all of them start in the same point. And I integrate for large time. So this is what you see. And then I plot on top of that the zero isostable, this kind of candidate for a limit cycle. And you can see that it kind of captures more or less a kind of a mean rotation, because there are some trajectories which complete the rotation for the outward part of the cycle, whereas there are others that complete the rotation going inwards this curve. In other words, we can also see this because if we analyze the amplitude trajectory for an individual trajectory, we can see that it drifts around zero. By contrast, if we take the mean, if we average a large number of trajectories, we can see how they decay exponentially, regardless we are taking the logarithm, towards this curve, okay? We also studied how this curve relates to the maximas of the stationary probability distribution. You can see it in here. And we see that it's near, but not corresponds to the maximas of this probability stationary distribution. Now, to continue digging into this idea of stochastic oscillators, let me consider the same model, but with anisotropic noise, okay? As always, I build the LDAPR operator for this system with this noise, I diagonalize it, I focus on the eigenfunctions associated to the eigenvalues of interest, and then I have my phase function and my amplitude function, which again, I can use to compute individual phase amplitude description of stochastic trajectories. And again, if I take 15 trajectories starting from the same point and I iterate it for last time, I see how nicely the zero of this amplitude function relates with the distribution of trajectories. And again, we can see that whereas individual trajectories drift around the zero, in average, they decay towards this curve. And again, we can also discuss which is the relationship or how it relates, or to show how it relates the maximas of the probability distribution with this zero isostable. And also let me show comparing the effective vector fields for the isotropic and the anisotropic case. In black, you have the deterministic case, and in blue, you have the effective vector field for the isotropic and anisotropic case. You see in this case, there are not too many differences. Both vector fields are kind of similar, as they are kind of the limit cycles they are generating. But by contrast, in here, you can see in these areas in which the differences are larger, the effective vector field changes. Okay, I prefer to start showing this methodology by means of a system that was having an underlying limit cycle because I think it was more natural, but our setup applies to also to noise-induced oscillations. That is, as I was saying, systems which oscillate because of noise, as it is the case of the stochastic spiral sink. Okay, now we will consider a Langevin equation in this form, where this matrix was this way, okay? So since mu is negative, this system has an attracting focus in absence of noise. Then, following the path open in this paper by Peter Thomas and Benjamin Lindner, we can obtain analytical expressions for all the magnitudes of interest, okay? The LDAPR operator works this way, okay? And this matrix, okay, is the noise, the symmetric diffusion matrix that you can see here, okay? Epsilon, I remark epsilon is taking more or less like the modulus of the total noise amplitude, more or less, related with the total noise amplitude we are putting into the system. And well, we will always do the same. We have a LDAPR operator and we care about the eigenfunctions associated with the eigenvalues of interest, that is, the ones having non-negative, negative real part being complex and real, purely real. And in this case, as one can show, this is the analytical expression for both functions, for the slowest decaying eigenfunction and the amplitude eigenfunction. Okay, so we can define a phase in this way. And since we have an expression for the amplitude, we can obtain an expression for the stochastic limit cycle. Okay, and we can also compute the effective vector field, which is quite nice expression to have, because you can see you have the original, the no-noise system, the deterministic system, plus an Statonovic drift term, which has a real and an imaginary part. Okay, and as you can see, the real part of this effective vector field shows how the dissipative effect of dynamics, that is, trajectories when being very far from the origin, they are pushed through the origin, combined with the expansive effect of noise, that is, near the origin, this term makes repels trajectories. So it has to be something in the middle capturing that, which is exactly our zero is a stable function, the effective limit cycle, the stochastic limit cycle. How can we see this? Well, because if we take this effective vector field and we express it in polar coordinates, you can see that exactly the fixed point of the radius corresponds exactly to the stochastic limit cycle, having this, the lambda floque, as a stable eigenvalue. So this example, as most of you know nowadays, this dynamical portrait, that is the stochastic spiral sink, is used intensively to describe fast brain oscillations. So we took, for example, parameters in this paper, although we could have taken parameters from a lot of groups, and we computed the magnitude of interest. Okay, just to say, for the set of parameters we consider, this system has these eigenvalues, so it has a stable focus in absence of noise. And as always, we build the Laguerre operator, we diagonalize it, we focus on the eigenfunctions associated to the eigenvalues of interest, we have our phase and amplitude functions, and then we can compute the phase amplitude of individual trajectories. And again, if we want to check how the stochastic limit cycle relates with the individual with the distribution of trajectories, okay, that's what we see. We see that trajectories decaying in the mean towards this curve. And again, we see there is no clear relationship between the maximas of the stationary probability distribution and the zero stochastic limit cycle. Okay, because in this case we know it's a 2D Gaussian with a maxima in the origin. And if we compute the effective vector field, okay, you can see that near the origin it changes. In blue is the effective vector field compared to the deterministic one. Okay. And to finish, I also would like to show another example we studied, which is having oscillation, noise-induced oscillations, that is an heteroclinic oscillator. We consider this system that has reflectory boundary conditions on this domain. And without noise, this system has an attractive heteroclinic limit cycle, but does not possess a finite period limit cycle. Okay? This model was studied in the paper, in the previous research by Peter and Benjamin. So we study for the same levels of noise, one weak, another larger. Okay. And again, we build the model, we diagonalize the Laguerre operator, we diagonalize it, and we focus on the eigenvalues as eigenfunctions associated to the eigenvalues of interest. So we can have for weak a large level of noise, phase, and amplitude functions, which also allow for description of phase amplitude trajectories. It is also nice to see how the zero isostable relates with the distribution of trajectories. You can see how it captures like a kind of a mean rotation of the system, because there are some trajectories that complete the rotation inwards, then go outwards. Well, as I was saying, no? This is nice to see by means of the amplitude, because it drifts around the zero, and you see how trajectories decay in average towards this curve. And also you can see how the zero isostable relates with the probability stationary distribution. because for smaller noise, the stationary distribution is precisely tight against the domain boundaries, because trajectories rarely visit the interior of the domain. That is why the zero isostable remains close to the domain walls. By contrast, for a large level of noise, this is trajectories spread around the phase space. Okay, that's what we obtain in this case. But the point is that since trajectories are likely to visit the interior of the domain, the zero isostable contracts, okay, towards the origin. And to finish, we can compute for the three levels of noise, for the deterministic case, for the weak, and for the large level of noise, the effective vector fields. And you can see, it's very nice to see how the noise makes the effective direction of the vector field to change instead of being parallel in the walls to point towards the interior of the origin. Therefore, or consequently, although the underlying vector field was not supporting a limit cycle, the effective vector field does. Let me conclude. We have shown that a phase amplitude description for stochastic oscillators can be achieved by means of the eigenfunctions of the L-Dagger, the Kolmogorov backwards operator. In other words, to this work by Peter Thomas and Benjamin Lindner on the asymptotic phase of stochastic oscillators, we have put, or we have add, this work computing the isostables for stochastic oscillators that you can find on archive. The addition and computation of the stochastic isostable allow us to define and study two interesting ideas, which are this stochastic limit cycle and this idea of the effective vector field. Remark also that the way that we have built this phase amplitude description is analogous with the way the Koopman operator defines a deterministic phase amplitude description of dynamics, as is, for example, shown in these two very nice references. And that is not by accident, because the Kolmogorov backwards operator, L-Dagger, is formally equivalent to the stochastic Koopman operator, as was, for example, shown in this reference. So therefore, we think, or we wonder about the possibility of extracting our phase amplitude functions, taking profit of these dynamical mode decomposition methods that are trying to extract these eigenfunctions from data. And just let me add a very few comments about future work. Because this talk is entitled Phase Amplitude Description of Stochastic Oscillators, and it's fair to say that for stochastic systems, there are two different notions of phase. One was coined by Julius Schwebedal and Arkady Pikowski in 2013. In this paper, they define a stochastic phase that we will denote as capital theta in terms of a system of Poincaré sections possessing a mean return time property. That is, if you take a point on those sections and you integrate one mean period, the expected value lies on that section. And then we have this phase by Peter and Benjamin that is more related with how the trajectory, let's say, decay to the stationary probability distribution. So you see it's different approaches. Just let me remark that in the noiseless case, when there is no noise, these two phases coincide, as is expected, because one is like analogous to the asymptotic phase, and the other is the definition of phase that we know in deterministic system equivalent based on mean return times in Poincaré sections. So we ask about which are the different properties that these two functions have, those two different phase functions have. And recently, a relationship between L-Dagger and this theta function was found at this work by Alexander Kao, Benjamin Lindner, and Peter Thomas. In particular, they found out that the mean return time phase satisfies this relationship. So this is the relationship between the mean return time phase and the L-Dagger operator. So since this eigenfunction is also related to the L-Dagger operator, we aim to exploit the link between these two phases and the L-Dagger operator to provide insight about the different properties of these two phases. That is a work that we have in preparation and we hope to have on archive during the next month. So that was it. We aim to found this kind of description, and we are very happy to show it in this meeting, because we think the applications of this in neuroscience, we look forward to discuss and to study the applications of these tools in neuroscience. Thank you very much for your attention. I'm more than happy to answer your questions.
Thank you, Alberto. I have a question here from Jonathan Rubin. What happens if you apply these ideas to an excitable two-time scale system with a stable focus near an Andronov-Hopf bifurcation?
Well, I have to say it's a very interesting question. Indeed, we plan also to study this in the context of different time scales. The point is that this work is very recent, so we are really exploring it. I can tell you I have applied this to a neuron model, which has kind of two different time scales as well. And I have seen that there is kind of a curve separating, let's say, sub-threshold oscillations from spiking. So in average, let's say, you are half of the time on the low threshold regime and half part of the time spiking, let's say. But that is a very interesting question that, of course, we will study in the future. I think this framework should work. I mean, at the moment, all the times I have applied it looks very robust. So, I mean, I look forward to work on that and show results in the future.
And, okay, yeah, John, I guess Peter is responding to you in the chat. And then Etienne asks, what do you obtain if you apply Friedland-Wenzel theory, large deviation results?
Well, to be honest, I don't know what is that theory. I'm sorry. I don't know, maybe Peter can ask or has a guess about, I'm sorry.
All right, yeah, so I had a question. So you mentioned that in the Stewart-Landau oscillator, your sort of mean limit cycle that you get is roughly the same as the original limit cycle.
Yes.
But that's not true in general of these systems, is it? And I guess what I was wondering is when you add noise, do the stochastic trajectories you see, do they typically shift more outside of the limit cycle? And are there any examples where if you add noise, you will get perturbed sort of stochastic trajectories that are more likely to be inside of the limit cycle?
Yeah, the key point is, let me see if I can illustrate it with this image, Zach. It's not the same to move, let's say, 0x or a given magnitude in amplitude towards inside that outside, in the sense that you see this is kind of this function is kind of a Gaussian, in the sense that you see in here a change in amplitude or a change in x is very few change in amplitude, whereas in here there is very large. Okay. Mm-hmm. So my point is that is what is going on in here, in the sense that in here, you are moving in amplitude, let's say more or less the same amount as in here. But then you go farther because you see in here moving 0.5, let's say in amplitude in this direction, is not the same as moving 0.5 in this direction because of this gradient. Indeed, this is nicely related to the gradients of the function.
Right. I get that. I'm just wondering if you add multiplicative noise or if you have other limit cycles with less symmetry, does the mean trajectory get warped by adding noise?
Sure. I mean, I don't see any reason why that should not happen if the system is like that. I mean, in the sense, maybe as you were saying, in the case of multiplicative noise or are likely for that to happen. I mean, I don't see any reason for that not to happen. But it's true that we consider systems that were having like the focus in the origin and that makes the gradient to be this way. And well, maybe that's why in most of the examples, trajectories go more to this direction than to this direction.
Right, yeah. Okay. All right. Well, thanks Alberto for a nice talk and for the nice discussion.